Good evening, everybody. Doug and Ann, thank you so much. This is truly a privilege for me to participate in the National Writers Series. I've been in the audience many, many times, but it's a thrill for me to have a chance to have a conversation with my good friend, Jim Tobin. And so, Jim, welcome. Here we are, just two guys from Northport.
Two old newspaper guys.
Coming to the big city to talk about books and writing. We're going to start out with the Ernie Pyle book. And I'm very interested in hearing how that idea evolved. You had suggested, told us backstage that it was an idea that really began to percolate when you were a journalism student at Michigan. But so tell us that story of how you came to want to write a book about a journalist in World War II.
Well, Ernie Pyle was a name that I had known growing up. My dad was a Marine veteran in World War II, and my mom had traveled around the country following him around to Marine bases and reading Ernie Pyle. And so it's a name that people of my generation, the children of World War II vets, knew quite well. But I'd never read any of his materials. Then in graduate school, I was starting to work on a dissertation about the home front in World War II and how people understood the war. And that's when I started to read Ernie Pyle's work, and I became fascinated by it. So that became part of my doctoral dissertation. But in the course of doing that work, I came across Ernie's personal letters, which are down at Indiana University, which is his alma mater. And I was just fascinated reading the letters of this writer whom I'd come to admire so much. So after graduate school and then working at the News, I sort of concocted this ambition that since there hadn't been a book about Ernie since shortly after the war, maybe I could be the guy who would write Ernie Pyle's biography. And so it went from there. My wife and I went down to the tiny town of Dana, Indiana, which is where Ernie Pyle is from. And we Xeroxed, I was riffling through papers. Then we went to Indiana University and did more work there and brought a bunch of microfilms and papers home. And so that's how I wound up in the basement at 4 o'clock in the morning, going through a lot of materials.
So when you started to write the book, you were basically making a really big leap from being a daily newspaper reporter to writing a historical biography. Talk about how you made that transition.
It's one more way in which you and your colleagues at the News helped me, because the News was friendly to long-form reporting, and it was friendly to reporters who were experimenting with narrative styles in our writing. That was a movement that was underway in the 90s, happening in a number of papers. I got interested in it, and you guys gave us the space and the freedom to develop that. So writing in the long form was not entirely new to me when I started the book. And I read a lot of biography. I sort of had the style, the genre in my head. So you just give it a try.
So today you're a teacher, but in the transition, did you still think of yourself as a reporter or as a budding historian?
Well, I certainly was going back to my training as a historian, somebody, you know, going through archives, doing rather painstaking research in published material and then what we call manuscript material, original materials, letters and diaries and so forth. So that was drawing on my history training at Michigan. But the writing was more journalistic. And so that sort of, I think, is what allowed me to create this hybrid style, which actually Doug Stanton and a number of other writers in this genre have, which is this kind of mix of serious historical research with the kind of paced storytelling narrative that you'd like to see in a good novel. So that's the sort of, it was a little of both. It was both serious history, but it was also journalism.
As the story of Ernie Pyle's life as a combat correspondent spun out, the story seemed to capture the inevitable conflict that journalists need to have, the need to tell the truth, And also about the terrible nature of war, and also the perceived obligation to persuade readers at home that yes, boys are dying, but their deaths are ennobling. Is that a concept that you found woven through the Pyle story?
I think it is. And you're quite right that war correspondents have wrestled with this. They see how awful war is, at least if they're doing their job. They get up close and they get a sense of what combat is really like, and that's a terrible story to have to tell. On the other hand, they come to admire the servicemen who were doing this terrible work. And I think in World War II, certainly, a particular kind of war that the country was united behind, they felt a certain obligation to support the war effort through their writing. And so that's what I think led to this mixture of themes in Pyle's work. War is awful, but the soldiers are making a heroic sacrifice. The soldiers are our servants, our suffering servants. There's almost a religious theme that comes into the portrait of the soldiers that Ernie and others wrote during the war.
Well, the stresses on combat correspondents are enormous. And in your book, After the Fall of Paris in 1944, you quote Pyle as saying, "He damn near had war neurosis. I'd become so revolted, so nauseated by the sight of these swell kids having their heads blown off that I just lost track of the whole point of the war." Isn't this what we have now come to call PTSD, post-traumatic stress syndrome, as our troops come home from Iraq and Afghanistan?
I think it is. I mean, it's interesting that quotation is from a letter of Ernie's, a private letter, not a column. Ernie did not write passages like that in his column. He came close to it a couple of times, but only a couple. I think that Ernie did suffer what we have called at various times shell shock, combat fatigue, PTSD. He was deeply affected, there's no question. He was a sensitive guy to begin with, not the most psychologically stable person to begin with. And so this did create enormous psychological, emotional stress on him. And he literally had to escape the war a couple of times. Now, at the same time, it's only fair to say that once he was away, then he felt an attraction to go back. And this is something that soldiers report too. They feel a sense of being alive, of being engaged in life, absorbed in a daily routine and in a purpose that you don't necessarily find in ordinary civilian life. So there's an appeal to combat too.
I'd like to give the audience a little flavor of his writing. And one of my favorite columns he wrote is about a captain named Henry T. Waskow, who was killed in Italy. Would you like to read that passage?
I'd like to. For us? This was when Ernie was in Italy. This is late 1943, the invasion of Italy, the Allied invasion that happened in September of 43. Ernie went shortly afterward and was with some units. This sort of sets the context. On December 13th, 1943, elements of the U.S. 36th Infantry Division climbed to the summit of a rocky hump called Mount Samucro, also known as Hill 1205. One of the endless series of German-held strongholds that separated the Americans from Rome. The Germans had been dislodged from the hilltop a day or two earlier, but now they were counterattacking, firing shells and mortars from the other side of the ridge. Ernie came to the foot of the mountain on December 14th. He found a small clay mine dug into the slope where soldiers were huddling to keep dry. A clearing was being used as a staging area for the mule trains. Ernie joined the men in the mine, settling in to watch as the mules started off or returned from the four-hour trek up the mountain. Near evening, a tall, thin soldier came into the clearing. A youngster of 19, he walked with the ginger tread of a trench foot victim, and Ernie, approaching him, saw he was distressed. The youngster, a private named Riley Tidwell, said his company commander had been killed by a shell that morning near the top of the mountain. He had been the captain's messenger. At the sound of incoming shells, the captain had pushed Tidwell to the ground, only to be fatally struck himself in the chest. To comfort the boy, Pyle said, "He must have been a fine man." And Tidwell said, "Yes, he had been like a father, quote, one of the finest people I ever met." Ernie moved on from there to the U.S. Air Base outside Naples, where he befriended a flyer named Edwin Bland, whose tent he shared for several days. One evening, he pulled a sheet of paper from his typewriter, assembled it with two other sheets, and handed the sheaf to Bland. He said, "Ed, see what you think of this." A few moments later, Bland handed it back and said, "Ernie, that's the finest thing I ever read." It was Pyle's account of the men at the base of the Mule Trail. So this is from the column. "At the front lines in Italy. In this war, I have known a lot of officers who were loved and respected by the soldiers under them, but never have I crossed the trail of any man as beloved as Captain Henry T. Wasco of Belton, Texas. Wasco was a company commander in the 36th Division. He was very young, only in his middle 20s, but he carried in him a sincerity and gentleness that made people want to be guided by him. I was at the foot of the Mule Trail the night they brought Captain Wasco down. The moon was nearly full at the time, and you could see far up the trail, and even partway across the valley. Soldiers made shadows as they walked. Dead men had been coming down the mountain all evening, lashed onto the backs of mules. A soldier came into the cowshed and said that there were bodies outside. We went out into the road. Four mules stood there in the moonlight, in the road where the trail came down off the mountain. The soldiers who led them stood there waiting. This one is Captain Wasco, one of them said quickly. Two men unlashed his body from the mule and lifted it off and laid it in the shadow beside the stone wall. Finally, there were five bodies lying end to end in a long row. You don't cover up dead men in the combat zones. They just lie there in the shadows until somebody comes after them. The uncertain mules moved off to their olive orchards. The men in the road seemed reluctant to leave. They stood around, and gradually I could sense them moving, one by one, close to Wasco's body. Not so much to look, I think, as to say something in finality to him and to themselves. I stood close by, and I could hear. One soldier came and looked down, and he said out loud, "God." That's all he said, and then he walked away. Another one came, and he said, "God to hell anyway." He looked down for a few less moments and then turned and left. Another man came. I think he was an officer. It was hard to tell officers from men in the half light, for everybody was grimy and dirty. The man looked down into the dead captain's face and then spoke directly to him as though he were alive. "Sorry, old man." Then a soldier came and stood beside the officer and bent over, and he too spoke to his dead captain, not in a whisper, but awfully tenderly, and he said, "I sure am sorry, sir." Then the first man squatted down, and he reached down and took the captain's hand, and he sat there for a full 5 minutes, holding the dead hand in his own and looking intently into the dead face, and he never uttered a sound all the time he sat there. Finally, he put the hand down. He reached up and gently straightened the points of the captain's shirt collar. And then he sort of rearranged the tattered edges of his uniform around the wound. And then he got up and walked away down the road in the moonlight all alone. The rest of us went back into the cowshed, leaving the five dead men lying in a line, end to end, in the shadow of the low stone wall. We lay down on the straw in the cowshed, and pretty soon we were all asleep.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to your second book, published in 2003, To Conquer the Air, The Wright Brothers and the Great Race for Flight. What was the passion that drove these two brothers as they experimented with gliders and trying to capture the essence of flight on the sand at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina?
Well, it started with Wilbur Wright. These two strange bachelor brothers living in Dayton, Ohio, owned a bike shop together, as everyone knows. And when they were young, they had fooled around with flying devices. There were kites then, and there were little gliders that you could toss, the way kids throw balsa wood gliders today. And this had stuck in Wilbur's mind. It wasn't really Orville's passion at the beginning. It was Wilbur's doing. And he started to fool around with ideas. He was reading about experiments in flight, which were going on in all parts of the world. And he started to think maybe he had a couple of ideas that would make a contribution to this experimentation. And so he was the one who did some research and found out that a good place to experiment with kites, large, possibly man-carrying kites, would be this very remote weather station outpost, Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. If you've all been to the Outer Banks, you know it's Traverse City with no trees. But it was then, you know, really a wilderness. And so he went down there, and Orville went along, and they started to fool around with these things, and they made more progress than I think they expected to, and so they got the bug. It was a hobby. It was something to have fun with. And the idea was really more, they were bicyclists, of course, and they had this idea, maybe if we could create a gliding operation, there we could have a new sport. We could have fun with it. Perhaps this would catch on. And so it went from there.
So you told me that the book has a slightly unusual structure and focus. What did you mean by that?
Well, it was my editor, actually, who asked me if I might be interested in a Wright Brothers book. And I just snapped to it immediately because I had been fascinated by the Wright Brothers as a kid. You know, I grew up around Detroit, and like many people here, probably went to Greenfield Village, you know, on field trips, and saw the bicycle shop and read the books. And so that had been in the back of my mind for a long time, and this brought it back. I mean, a little bit like with Ernie, it allowed me to revisit this thing that I had enjoyed thinking about when I was a kid. And so the question was, there had been obviously books about the Wright brothers, very fine books about the Wright brothers. What might I do that would be different, have a fresh angle? And so one of the main things I thought about was to emphasize Wilbur's role, because I think that really was, he really was the dominant of the pair, and that hasn't been well understood. But then I started to realize that there were competitors, very important competitors, very well-known competitors, and that it went on not only after the famous flight of December 17, 1903 at Kitty Hawk, the first powered manned human flight, but beyond that, where people didn't believe them, and newspaper reporters got the story wrong, of course, and then Alexander Graham Bell he had his own ideas about flight that he thought were far superior to the Wright brothers. And then people know the name Glenn Curtis who got involved in this. And so I realized that what had always been seen as this sort of isolated historic deed by the Wright brothers alone had a context. It was a competition. And so I thought maybe that's the story. That led to this more what I call a braided narrative, where you have several important characters whose lives are intersecting. Wilbur Wright sort of at the center of the story, but these others orbiting Wilbur. So that's the somewhat tricky structure of the book. I hope it works well as you read it, but it's not just the story of a single protagonist.
And so recently along comes the noted historian David McCullough with a book about the Wright brothers. I'm interested in your sort of reflections on that.
Well, that's the thing, is that McCullough, whom I admire enormously, a wonderful writer, he went back to the old model, essentially, of just telling the story of the Wright brothers. Okay, he's David McCullough, he's, you know, that works for him. But this approach that I took is different, and I hope a little bit more interesting. I think it's a more layered portrait of what was going on. What can I say? He's entitled to his place on the bestseller list. Great writer.
There's a passage in the book in which you describe and compare the two brothers. Would you be careful to read that for us, please?
Right. Yeah. The bonds between the two brothers were extraordinary. At one level, they were the same bonds that unite any close siblings, those of common experience and a shared way of looking at things. Scattered through the letters and their letter, and the letters of their sister Catherine, wonderful character in the story, Catherine Wright. Much more likable than the brothers, actually. Scattered through their letters and Catherine's is a family code of mangled words and phrases. Great big sing, success, them is fine. These were undoubtedly funny things that had been said by small children, the Wrights themselves or their nieces and nephews, and then recycled to fit new occasions down through the years. They were the threads of small events and mishaps, of walks to school and long Sundays that formed the weave of a shared life. Another bond between the two brothers was intellectual. They shared a deep curiosity, a love of discovery, and a yen to solve problems. Of course, many families produce two children who think rather alike, but few produce two children who think together, though to outsiders, the brothers' way of thinking looked less like cooperation than combustion. They argued for sport, their voices rising, relishing the debate as they might have relished a tennis match, whacking assertions and evidence back and forth. I love to scrap with Orv, Wilbur said once. Orv is such a good scrapper. From the fracas, ideas emerged. They enjoyed the fight, but the fight was also a method, and the tougher the fight, the better the results. There were also bonds of purpose and of character. The brothers disagreed all the time about technical matters and occasionally about business tactics, but never about what they wanted to accomplish or what was right or wrong. Their judgments of people seemed to have been identical. In hundreds of letters they exchanged, there is scarcely a single overt expression of affection. Yet the letters also leave no doubt that each put the other first in his loyalties, that each trusted the other utterly and understood him completely. Outsiders often found the two men virtually indistinguishable. Their handwriting was similar. They were about the same height. Will was taller at 5'9.5". Same weight, 140 pounds. Same blue-gray eyes. A stranger said if you closed your eyes, you couldn't tell which one was talking. They finished each other's sentences. When one finished making a point, the other often said, that's right. Both undoubtedly possessed intellectual gifts of a very high order. But Orville's intelligence tended to be purely practical, while Will was both practical and wise. He saw more and thought more broadly. It appears that he had the superior imagination of the two and extraordinary powers of concentration. Once the brothers began to talk about the problem of flight in earnest, their ideas became more or less indissoluble. But it is impossible to imagine Orville, bright as he was, supplying the driving force that started their work and kept it going from the back room of a store in Ohio to conferences with capitalists, presidents, and kings. Wilbur did that. He was the leader from the beginning to the end.
Thank you. Well, there have been numerous volumes written about Franklin Delano Roosevelt and the Roosevelt family, and most of those books treated his bout with polio as an isolated incident, rather than, and you saw it as a critical element in Roosevelt's life. Where did the idea germinate that led you to wanting to write about this seminal phase in FDR's life?
Well, I had been interested in FDR since I was a kid. I like to tell the story of my grandmother, a great New Deal Democrat, a music teacher in the Detroit Public Schools, who worshipped FDR. And I think my earliest memory of politics was of her telling me about this heroic man who had braces and crutches, and he stood to cross a stage to give a speech. He had had polio, which I knew about and was frightened of. And that image, you know, that stayed in my mind, as you'd expect. Then, after the Wright book was done, I was looking for a new topic. I had enjoyed writing about the family, the Wright family. And also at the News, I had covered medicine for a while, and although I have no background in science or medicine, I had enjoyed writing about that, and I realized the drama that's inherent in medical difficulties. And so, speaking of David McCullough, I had been quite taken by an early book of his, Mornings on Horseback, which focuses on the childhood of Theodore Roosevelt and the struggle that family had with his childhood asthma. really interesting book and an interesting story about illness and how it affects a family. So these things came together, and I thought, has anybody really done a good narrative job on the polio story? And so I looked into that, and I thought there was kind of an opportunity, and so that's when I started in on the research.
Roosevelt said little and wrote less about his condition. There were apparently no diaries or journals to guide you to draw on. So where did you draw your primary sources from in researching this?
This was the toughest part of the book. It's a good question. As I got to the Franklin Roosevelt Library in Hyde Park, New York, some of you may have seen it, beautiful place on the Hudson River, I thought, wow, presidential library is just going to be, you know, spilling over with great documentation about FDR and polio. And then I got into the personal papers from that era. I started to realize that was the last thing he was talking about in his letters to his friends. I mean, he would mention it only passingly. It was always extremely optimistic and upbeat. Oh, I'm getting better. The doctors couldn't be more enthusiastic. And I was really stumped for a while. Where do I draw the documentation? Well, so it was kind of this process of looking for 100 needles in 1,000 haystacks. Gradually, those pieces started to come together. And then I think that an important idea that occurred to me one day in sort of my frustration over the lack of direct evidence, direct conversation about it, and this was true of Eleanor's materials too, I thought the silence, that's part of the story. They're not talking about it. Why? And what does that mean? And so then I started to look at this a little bit differently. And I started to learn more about what the psychological and emotional experience of disability is like for people, especially people who are struck by a traumatic injury, you know, in midlife, as FDR was. And it has this shattering effect, both on individuals and families. And many people deal with it, as the Roosevelts did, through a kind of subtle process of first extremely hard, dedicated work, but also of a kind of denial, a denial that this is going to hold you back. And the less you acknowledge it in conversation with others, the more you're able to convince them that it hasn't impacted you, that it hasn't stopped you. And so I learned by reading the memoirs of other polio people that this is a pretty common pattern. And I got fascinated by that. One of the best things I read about this, and my wife Lisa steered me to this book, is a book by an anthropologist now dead named Robert Murphy, who was the chair of the anthropology department at Columbia. He didn't have polio, but he had a congenital spinal illness that left him more and more paralyzed from the waist down. So he had symptoms like FDR's. And this memoir that he wrote called The Body Silent, which I would recommend to anybody interested in this area, is this incredible evocation of what it's like to lose the ability to walk and trying to continue to have a family life and a career. Your mind is absolutely whole, and you're not even FDR. You know, FDR was perfectly healthy after the polio virus was gone from his body. But people would still say, oh, well, he's in ill health. Well, he wasn't in ill health. He was perfectly fine. He just couldn't walk. So this is a terrible psychological ordeal. I thought I was going to be writing about a physical process. I really wound up writing more about a psychological process and then a social process, the process of interacting with others. That became FDR's great challenge, the stigma that people placed on him, that he had to disarm. That became the real challenge of his political comeback.
Different writers have different methods of recording their interviews and filing their notes and so on. How do you handle this part of the research?
In a state of chaos and craziness. I had a great talk with Doug Stanton just last night about his method. We're both using this new software, which is called Scrivener. I don't know if anybody's tried it. Really interesting writing software. But I find since I put away my file cards, that there's always like this will-o'-the-wisp that a great new technological breakthrough is going to happen that's going to make the whole writing and research process absolutely seamless and easy. So I've tried 18 different things. One thing that has happened that makes things a lot easier and less expensive for historians is simply the iPad and the iPhone, so that you can take pictures of documents that you're going through in a library like the FDR Library. Saves on Xerox costs. The federal government charges, I think, 50 cents a page now for photocopying. And so that takes care of that. Then you make PDFs out of your photographs, and that helps, but there's still a massive process of organization. So since you asked the inside baseball question, I'll tell you I use a piece of software called DevonThink, which is a way of organizing any kinds of files, easily searchable, sort of endlessly capacious. You can put as much stuff in there as you want to. That's how I organize my notes. And then normally I just then use Microsoft Word to write, but this, as I say, this new Scrivener thing I'm fooling around with, it may be the big breakthrough we've all been waiting for.
In the opening chapter, you begin with a description, really it's kind of a tutorial, on the polio virus and how it works. Would you mind reading that?
This was a tricky process to figure out how much science to include in this book, so I started to think of the virus, the polio virus, as a character in the story. So this is the start of the first chapter, as Bob says, and it kind of captures the virus as protagonist here for a moment. The date on the chapter is July 28, 1921. The virus that causes poliomyelitis entered Franklin Roosevelt's body in the summer of 1921. At the moment of infection, he was a famous and vigorous young man on the rise toward national leadership. The virus was small beyond imagining. 10 more years would go by before the first electron microscopes revealed that the poliovirus resembles a distant planet inscribed with tiny canyons. The virus is not alive in the way a bird is alive, or even in the way a bacterium is alive. It is nothing more than a little sphere of fat enclosing a smaller strip of genetic material. It cannot move by itself. It does not eat or breathe. It is at most half alive, a parasite. To reproduce, it must enter a human body and survive an onslaught from the protective machinery of the body's immune system, then blunder up against a welcoming cell in the human intestine. If the virus can burrow inside that cell, its fatty capsule dissolves, exposing the strip of genetic chemicals within. And then a bizarre meshing of genetic equipment ensues. Like the two sides of a zipper, the strip from the virus unites with a matching strip from the intestinal cell, forming an assembly line that begins to duplicate the original virus by the thousand. Overloaded, the cell bursts. The virus's progeny collide with neighboring cells, and the multiplication spreads. Even then, the effect of this submicroscopic production would likely be negligible. Most of the virus's human hosts suffer nothing worse than a headache and a mild fever. The immune system overwhelms the virus and flushes it out of the body, and the human host goes on with life none the wiser. But in a fraction of those infected, fewer than 1%, the virus escapes from the intestinal tract into the central nervous system. It has an affinity for certain cells in the spinal cord that govern the movement of muscles. If the virus finds these cells, it destroys them, sometimes only a few, sometimes a great many. The number of spinal cord cells destroyed determines the fate of the human host. If only a few cells are destroyed, the host might be only temporarily hobbled and then recover completely. If a great many cells are destroyed, depending on their number and location, he might be left badly damaged or dead. Outside the human host, the virus can escape disintegration for as long as 6 months. To propagate, its only purpose, if it can be said to have a purpose, it must find its way into a susceptible human being. Its best chance of doing so comes in the heat of summer.
And how did the virus get in Roosevelt's body?
Well, it's pretty clear from the timing that Roosevelt was infected at a Boy Scout campout at a big state park, Bear Mountain State Park, Harriman State Park. There are two conjoined parks, the first two great state parks in America. North of New York City, Roosevelt was chairman of the local Boy Scouts, and just trying to make a name for himself in New York politics. He had a name already, but he was starting to run for office in New York. So he was doing various civic duties. And this camp out was up at Bear Mountain in a place where, I think I'm the first one who figured this out, thanks to the internet and Google Books, that there was contamination in the water supply. And so either from contaminated water or from one of the Boy Scouts coming up from New York City, he accidentally caught a hold of this virus and ingested it. And because we know that 12 days later is when his symptoms started to appear, that's the incubation period for the polio virus. That's the only time he was with any significant number of children. He wasn't even with his own children at that point. And so that's almost surely where it happened.
You tell us that you have given a great deal of thought to the lexicon of decibility. The 1920s were decades away from what we call an era of political correctness, when cripple is not a word we use today, but you use it in the book and you provide a very thoughtful explanation of why you did that.
Well, I noticed, Bob, you know, that in the bookstore today, I saw Donald Trump's new book, Crippled America. So I'm in good company using the
You're
word.
You're in good company.
The word cripple was ubiquitous in the 20s. It carried the stigma of invalidism. I looked back at the etymology of the word and found out that comes from these old German and Dutch words that come from the root word to crawl. And so you realize that's how in ancient times people with disabilities like this, it was the only way they could move. They crawled across the ground. So it likens them to animals. So it is a stigmatizing word, and yet people used it. Roosevelt used it about himself and about others. And it was so common that I found that it strained credulity not to use it. And that by using it in the book, I helped to bring the reader back into that era. And that's obviously what the book tries to do, is to take the reader and place him or her down in this different time and place. So it's part of sort of establishing the social context. And I haven't had a single person say that they were offended by it. I've done events like this with polio survivors, and nobody's objected to it yet. I may have offended people without knowing it, but they haven't told me so.
As a young man, FDR was thought to have had a charmed life. He had health, wealth, charm, great good looks, education. Why did this perception that he was a likable lightweight overlook the reality of his ambition and his gigantic will to recover?
Well, I don't think Roosevelt himself understood the true nature of his character until he went through this great ordeal. He certainly had the ambition for the presidency from the time, at least, that he was in college. He talked about it with friends then. And you know, you can't underestimate the enormous influence of the example of Theodore Roosevelt in Franklin Roosevelt's life. They were distant cousins, but Eleanor Roosevelt was Theodore Roosevelt's niece, favorite niece. And so when FDR married Eleanor, Theodore Roosevelt became his Uncle Ted by marriage. And I think that wasn't the smallest factor in the marriage proposal. but things did come easily to FDR. He grew up in a privileged situation, wealthy family, Harvard, Groton School, the great prep school. Columbia Law School, his mother got him a job at a big Wall Street law firm. He was asked to run for the New York State Legislature. So, and then grace came to him again when he was chosen for Woodrow Wilson's cabinet, largely because of his name. And so, even though he did a good job as Assistant Secretary of the Navy during World War I, there had been no great challenge in his life. And so this is the crisis, you know, that we all have these crises, some not so dramatic as this one, not so terrible, that call on us to show who we are and what we're made of. And so, you know, I think he knew that he had capacity that others hadn't seen, but I think that he learned on his own through overcoming this, that he had the will and the grit and the drive and the ambition that was going to carry him forward. I mean, there are qualities in his personality that are not altogether likable in some ways, but they certainly propelled him forward through this crisis.
Conventional wisdom is that FDR deceived the public about his disability. You say that's incorrect. What really happened?
This comes up again and again. I think that through 20, 30 years of sort of superficial TV documentaries, people have conceived the wrong idea about how this went. And it's also partly an effect of sort of post-Watergate, post-Monica Lewinsky cynicism about the nature of the presidency. What presidents do is deceive the public. It's a much subtler situation than that. In the 20s, in fact, I think the major argument that the book makes is that FDR used what had happened to him with polio to construct a kind of new public persona for himself. I mean, it wasn't an untrue one, but he made it clear what he had been through, that he had been through this tempering. He was a comeback kid, you know. He was a guy who had gone through something very, very difficult. So it allowed him both to identify with people less fortunate than he, and it allowed them to identify with him. I think it was really critical to his first winning the governorship of New York and then winning the presidency. Now, the fact is that especially once he became president, FDR limited his exposure in public, the exposure of the true severity of his disability. He was perfectly frank about the fact that he had polio. Everybody who read the newspapers knew it. There were lengthy newspaper and magazine stories, books written about the nature of his disability, books written with his cooperation and approval, so this was no secret. But, and I learned a lot about this from a couple of interviews that I did with the Roosevelt's oldest grandson, Curtis Roosevelt, now in his 80s, who lived in the White House as a teenager during World War II. He was one of the few surviving people that I could talk to who really had seen Franklin Roosevelt up close in intimate private settings and heard him talk about everything in his life. But Curtis Roosevelt told me that the business about not being photographed, discouraging newsreel cameras from taking footage of him, was that he was always afraid that he was going to fall down in public. Now, we all remember what happened when the first George Bush lost his dinner on the lap of the Japanese prime minister. Well, that could happen once and everybody laughed. Imagine that happening several times, and you'd start to think, what's wrong with this guy? If Franklin Roosevelt had fallen in public, and Roosevelt did fall in private, the business of moving from a wheelchair to a regular chair like this, and he would sit in a chair much like this, was a tricky little maneuver. Sometimes his feet would slip. Sometimes somebody helping him would make a misjudgment about how to help him, and he would fall. Now, everything was fine. He never hurt himself. He took it all very easily and lightly when it happened, but he didn't want that to be captured on film. And you know, he did fall once or twice in public as president. There was a time during the 1936 campaign, he was on a rostrum like this and was moving up to give a speech. FDR could walk with assistance. He wore braces in those situations from his waist to his heels. He had a cane and he'd hold on to a Secret Service agent or one of his sons. He would get to his feet and he would walk. But in one of those situations, a gentleman who was up on the stage with him reached for his hand at the wrong moment. And FDR sort of instinctively moved forward, and the balance was off, and he went down. Now, this was written about afterward, but not at the time. And I think that, you know, there's sort of this view that the White House press corps was in a conspiracy to hush all this up. That's not really what happened. Reporters in those days, and we've talked about this a little bit, I think, there was a certain reticence about reporting on both the private life and the person of the president. That was off limits. Reporters were friendly with FDR, but that wasn't why they gave him a break. They knew that he was capable of the job. This had started when he was governor of New York. And they were not going to make a big deal out of the fact who was, that this guy, who was obviously capable of performing the duties of the presidency, had slipped and fallen. So put away the conspiracy theories, if these are in your mind, and rest assured that this was an act of a kind of privacy, a sense of dignity. It was nobody's business how he got around in the White House. And it was important to him to stand, to be able to stand up and address a crowd. He made that as a symbolic show of strength. But otherwise, he was going to be careful about how his legs were displayed. Just as this was really important, and I mentioned earlier how he would deflect attention from the disability to erase the stigma, to put people at ease. FDR was an extremely talkative person. People would say they would come into the office, they'd get 5 minutes of the president's time, and they were desperate to give their message, you know, to ask the president what they wanted to ask for, and instead, Franklin Roosevelt would talk nonstop for 45 minutes, and then he would say, "Well, I've got to be running along now," and off the visitor would go. But that sort of loquaciousness, the animation of his face, he would toss his head around. Those were subtle ways of deflecting attention from his legs. And so this story is a lot more complicated than a kind of deception. It's a performance. That's what I like to call it, a performance.
There were two powerful women in his life, his mother, Sarah Delano Roosevelt, and his wife, Eleanor. Describe his mother's role as a perceived obstacle to a lot of the ideas about curing and getting him stronger.
Yeah. Well, Sarah Roosevelt was a formidable person. Also, I think, a little misunderstood, a really fine person. She's portrayed as the ogre mother-in-law, you know, and it's true that Eleanor Roosevelt, it was tough to be Sarah Roosevelt's daughter-in-law, let's put it that way. You know, if you've been to the Hudson Valley and you've seen the Roosevelt estate, and then you know you've seen Eleanor's stone cottage called Valkill, well, Valkill is 2 miles that way because Eleanor didn't want to spend the night every night with Sarah in the big house. So there was a difficult relationship, but also a loving relationship. When FDR gets sick, Sarah, you know, understandably, her only child, her revered only child, she couldn't imagine that a man disabled as he was could possibly go back into public life. My goodness, he was an invalid. He had to be shut away. They were situated in life in such a way that he could have a wonderful life back at the estate at Hyde Park. He could do his stamp collection, he could write, he had talked about writing, this would give him the leisure to do that. And by heavens, he wasn't going to mix with politicians anymore. She hadn't liked that idea much to begin with, and she certainly didn't like it, like the prospect of him doing it once he had become disabled. FDR heard none of that, and Eleanor was sympathetic to Franklin in this. Eleanor did not believe for quite some time that it could be possible for FDR to make a comeback in politics. Nobody thought that. I mean, it was just ridiculous. It was a ridiculous notion. No one had ever been crippled and run for office, been a leader of anything. But she did believe that he had to keep his hand in politics. He had to keep talking with people. He loved politics. And she wanted him to continue those activities and perhaps have some role as an advisor, you know, a writer, a power behind the scenes. And so she invited people to their homes in New York and Hyde Park, kept him active in that way. She ran the household with 5 children at home, and, you know, nurses and nannies and the mother-in-law and I mean, Eleanor really had her hands full. And then this husband, who all I could think about was his medical recovery. Not much good with the kids to begin with, and certainly wasn't after that. This is the familial crisis that led to 5 unhappy children who had 19 marriages between them. So the Roosevelt family did not produce happy offspring.
Well, a factor in Eleanor and Franklin's relationship was his secretary, Missy Lehand, who, after about a year of his illness, became a full-time companion to him. And you suggest somewhat more like a wife than Eleanor. How did Eleanor deal with this?
Most of you probably know the story of Lucy Rutherford, Lucy Mercer Rutherford, who had been Eleanor's social secretary. She and FDR had an affair during World War I, which Eleanor discovered, broke her heart, almost broke the marriage up. Sarah Roosevelt said, Franklin, if you divorce Eleanor, you will never get another penny from me. That was one factor that kept the marriage together. We don't know that it was... We don't know that it was the only factor. We know that Franklin Roosevelt loved Eleanor Roosevelt and loved her till the end of his life. Very complicated relationship. But not an intimate one from that point on, certainly. Eleanor was terrific in the polio crisis. She had nurse's training, literally helped nurse him in the early period. So Missy Lehand comes on board. She had been a secretary in the political campaign in 1920 when Roosevelt ran for vice president. And I think, this is escaping me, but I think it was Eleanor who actually recommended that she come on as FDR's legal secretary. They were very close. She was an extraordinary, capable woman. There's a brand new book, this biography, the first full biography of Missy Lehand that's just been written, hasn't been published yet, so I'm looking forward to reading that. And you know, we don't know the nature of their relationship. Maybe I'll discover it in this book, but I don't think the documents are there that show, you know, did they or didn't they, which is what everybody wants to know. I know that's what you were really asking, Bob. FDR was capable of having sex. We don't know if he did or not. And there was a book written about FDR and Lucy some years ago by a writer whose name will be familiar to many, Joseph Persico, called Franklin and Lucy, I think it's called. And so he speculates about all this. And he did get Lucy's children to give up some of the personal letters between them because they continued their relationship, although FDR had promised Eleanor he wouldn't see her anymore. The fact is he did later in life when he was president. They had a friendship that continued. And Lucy was with FDR when he died in 1945. So what's the question? Okay, so I know, the review of that Persico book by Charles McGrath at the New York Times Book Review, he said, you know, at the end of the day, I think that FDR liked to have a cocktail with a couple of younger, admiring woman friends and have them listen to him and enjoy his conversation and laugh at his jokes. And the fact that we want to read sex into that probably says more about our generation than it does about his generation. And when I read that, I thought, you know, I think maybe he's got that about right. The children, the Roosevelt children, who all published, not all, but some published bad books about their parents, differed about whether Missy and their father had a physical affair. One thought they did, one thought they didn't. I'm of the mind that, I think it was James Roosevelt who said, you know, father was, as I was saying earlier, private about his body and the difficulty of engaging in sex as a person paralyzed from the waist down, though not impossible, would have been too much for him. I hope I'm not offending by speaking too frankly, you know, it is a question. I think that Missy Lehand was in love with FDR, not much doubt about that, but that they had this very sort of close, as you say, companionship, this kind of fine friendship between them. And FDR leaned on her, relied on her, largely as an absolutely indispensable assistant, and a great deal of affection for her. And he provided for her in his will. She became very ill during World War II and was incapacitated and died before he did as a young woman. A close relationship, you asked about, I mean, Eleanor thought of Missy as a sort of a surrogate daughter. She thought the world of Missy. And by that point, you know, Eleanor had her life, her personal friendships, which were very close in some cases, and they were leading this unusual life as partners. Political partners, both parents of their children, both dealing with Sarah Roosevelt. It was a full-time job to do all those things. And so I think she was comfortable with the idea that her husband and Missy Lehand were close. It was okay with her.
We're going to bring our conversation to a close and turn to the audience for their questions, but I want to ask you one final question. You describe Roosevelt's comeback as the greatest in American political history. An important moment in that course of comeback was a speech he made to the 1924 Democratic Convention. Talk for a moment about that, and then we'll go to questions.
Okay. Well, this was a big moment, and I realized during the research that this was the moment that my grandmother had told me about. This was the 1924 convention, Madison Square Garden. I think she got it from the movie that some of you may remember, Sunrise at Campobello, with Ralph Bellamy as FDR. So I was really getting kind of Ronald Reagan versions of history, you know, through my grandmother. Reagan would tell a history that he'd seen in a movie. Well, this was, don't let me go on too long here, Bob, because it's a little bit involved, but after he got sick in 1921, he goes through intensive physical therapy for a couple of years and makes some progress, but not a great deal of progress. He can stand, he can walk with crutches, but it's very difficult. And he starts to get his hand back in politics in some ways, largely through advising and working with the great governor of New York, Al Smith, the great Democrat of his era, a guy polar opposite of FDR in many ways, a man of the streets, a guy who'd never finished school. But he and FDR formed this kind of alliance. Smith wanted the support of blue blood Democrats like FDR. So he got FDR to be sort of the titular chairman of his presidential campaign in 1924, and he asked him if he would nominate him at the 24 convention, and Roosevelt said he would. Now, this was a moment of his reemergence into public life. 4 years before, in San Francisco, Roosevelt, still absolutely this vigorous, athletic young guy, had been nominated for vice president. So that was when most of these Democratic delegates in 1924 had seen him for the first time, vigorous young guy giving this speech, bounding up on the stage. So now the spectacle is very different. The time comes for FDR to give his speech. The Madison Square Garden is absolutely jammed to the rafters, mostly with Smith supporters. And Jimmy Roosevelt, the guy I just quoted, like 19 years old, is prepared to help his father up the steps and to the rostrum. And so once this begins, this process begins, the whole place just goes absolutely silent, watching this man struggle across this stage. And Frances Perkins, who became Roosevelt's Secretary of Labor, great woman, who left the greatest in the form of an oral history, a lengthy oral history, the greatest account of the Roosevelt years that we have, describes this moment in detail, and she was sitting like right there. And she said, we could see the sweat rolling down his neck. We could see when he got to the rostrum finally, and he grabbed it with both hands. He puts down the crutch, Jimmy steps away, and he's got the rostrum like this. Well, he's barely able to stand up. You know, he's like this. His legs are stiffly straight because of these braces from waist to toe. He can't bend at all. And if he lets go of this rostrum, he's going to fall over. So he can't raise his hand and wave the way anybody would, any politician would. So he threw up his head and he smiled, the great Roosevelt smile. And Frances Perkins and all the other witnesses said it just tore the place apart. Well, that was the beginning of Roosevelt's comeback, because he made this, you know, great speech for Al Smith. Smith lost the nomination battle. He would be nominated 4 years later. More of Roosevelt's story there. But the New York Democratic Party started to say, this guy is back. Can he run for office? Is he going to be able to run for the U.S. Senate? Is he going to be able to run for governor? And so that starts this drumbeat where Roosevelt, not yet ready physically to make a campaign, is trying to make a comeback. That's what drives him to Warm Springs, Georgia, just a couple months after that convention appearance. He hears about Warm Springs at the convention and goes down there to try and find a new miracle cure. Leads to more physical recovery, rehabilitation. He does recover the ability to walk with assistance better, and then it's on to the to 1928 and the governorship.
Thank you very much, Jim. Would you bring the house lights up? Well done. That was terrific.
Thank you.
We have, we welcome your questions. We have microphones around the room. Please tell us your name. This conversation will be broadcast on IPR, and we'd like to know the identity of those asking questions. So who has the first question?
Hi. In the back. My name is Bill Smith from Traverse City. Thank you very much for this interesting conversation. I'm wondering if his disability in any way affected his legislative proposals, his views towards civil rights, towards other people with disabilities. Did it have any effect in his legislative agenda?
Eleanor Roosevelt was asked after FDR was dead, would your husband have become president without, if he had not had polio? And she said, yes, I think he would have, but he would have been a different kind of president. That may be true, and it is said that it had effects on him. I don't think you can tie anything directly to any piece of legislation directly to his condition. Although he was, as governor, he did a great deal for crippled children in New York State, especially, and was always sympathetic to the problems of the disabled. But FDR wanted to be president of the United States. He didn't want to be a crusader for the rights of the disabled. And so, that was just long before there was any kind of disability rights movement. What I think you can say is that it gave him a sense of identification with people who suffered. And especially when he became president, we were in a nation of sufferers in 1932, 1933, in the midst of the worst part of the Great Depression. So his empathy and his compassion, I think, it's not that he had been an unfeeling person before this happened. You couldn't make that shift. But he really learned. He grew. Francis Perkins, whom I just mentioned, said that FDR, one of the greatest things about FDR, his true greatness, was the ability to grow. He was a late bloomer in many ways. One biographer in particular has made this point. And you sort of see that even in the presidency, that he comes more and more into his role, grows into his role. Polio was part of that, but I think it was also a kind of endemic to his nature. Yeah.
Do I see a hand up somewhere? Right here in front, please.
This is a plant in the audience, my friend Kim Clark.
My name is Kim Clark, and I have the privilege of knowing and working with Jim. When you write a biography, when you research and write a biography, I'm sure you come to know this person. You feel like you almost have a relationship with them. Of the four men you've written about, who would you want to sit on a stage like this with and talk to and ask
Ernie
questions
Pyle.
Of? And why?
Well, Ernie was just a great soul. I really did feel that I knew Ernie better than he knew himself. That was not possible with Franklin Roosevelt. If Wilbur Wright were sitting here, I would be in awe because he was this extraordinary genius, and he probably wouldn't have thought that I understood his experiments very well and got a bunch of stuff wrong. Probably would have told me so. I'd love to meet FDR. But FDR would have treated me the way he would have treated all of us. He would have charmed the socks off us, and we wouldn't have gotten to know anything about him. A very closely held person. Robert Sherwood, who great playwright and one of FDR's speechwriters, said in his book, Roosevelt and Hopkins, I tried to look into that forested interior, and I never could figure out what was going on in there.
In the back, please.
My name's Dustin Webb. To kind of piggyback off the last question, how hard, when you're getting to know these people as you're doing their research, is it for you to stay objective in how you approach the story that you're going to tell about them?
There's that word, objective.
Yeah, right.
Come to my class, Journalism 101. We'll talk about objectivity. It's the most difficult philosophical principle that I've ever come across. Objectivity. I'm not sure I know what you mean by it. You tell me what you mean by it, and then we'll talk about that. I see. Yeah, it's a very good question. I think that as a writer, the person I'm trying to serve is you, the reader. Okay? So my obligation should be not to make Ernie Pyle look good or not to make Franklin Roosevelt look good, there's the controversial figure, but to try very hard to capture what Roosevelt was like and why he did the things that he did and convey that to you. My obligation is to the reader. So as much as I might come to like a person I'm writing about, I have to keep that obligation in mind. I think this is the journalism training. That's what we learn. And so although I got fond of Ernie and I got fond of Wilbur Wright especially, and his sister Catherine Wright, I never felt like I was struggling to be honest about them. I mean, the thing I find hard to write about is somebody who's alive, okay? This was a great reason to go back into history. You know, I could just write about dead people. And I'm always telling my students that. If, you know, if this makes you uncomfortable, just go into history. So I guess that's how I would answer your question. It hasn't been a struggle for me. We say that objectivity, a friend of Bob's named Bill Kovach, who's written a great book called The Elements of Journalism, says that objectivity is not, a person cannot be objective. A person can use objective methods. A person can test for the truth, like a scientist tries to test hypotheses. To be accurate, to be fair, to be thorough. Those are the values that I try to bring to the research, as opposed to this kind of ineffable, undefinable state of objectivity. Objectivity is when you have no values. I don't care to write without values. I want to say what I think is good and bad. So that's why objectivity I don't see as kind of the right goal.
And here in the front, please.
I'm Nick Stratz. I'm just wondering, I've always been a history fan reader, and I'm wondering, what are the pros and cons of between your writing and David McCullough's?
Well,
the pros of David McCullough's writing are that it's been read by so many more people. Don't ask my wife this question. She has a very strong opinion. To tell you the truth, David McCullough is one of my heroes, and I try to write like he does. There's a clarity to his writing. One of the things I like about McCullough's style is that it's very, it's unadorned. It's straightforward and fairly simple. And yet still has an eloquence to it. So if anybody ever said, gee, I think you write like David McCullough, I'd be very complimented. I mean, in some ways the styles are pretty similar. I'm not saying I'm as good as he is, but I think in some ways my style is kind of like his. He's certainly a great writer to emulate. If you try to write history, you can do much worse than to try to model your work on David McCullough's. I mean, look at the results. I mean, it's he's had an astonishing career. Started as a journalist, worked for Time Life, I think.
Yes.
Then went to American Heritage, and that's where he started to write, you know, in this vein of popular history. I think he was very much influenced by the great historian Bruce Catton, mm-hmm. from down Crystal Lake way. Catton really, writing after World War II and then having great popularity with the Civil War books of the 1960s, I think influenced McCullough, who in turn influenced lots of other journalists writing history. So he's been a very important figure.
We have a question here.
Okay.
I'm wondering if you know who your next subject is, and is there a woman in history who intrigues you as a possible subject?
Yeah. My editor said when I took up FDR, he said, you know, if you can get women into this story, that would be a good thing, because women buy books. The next project is what I'm working on now is a kid's book about FDR and polio. Same story, different audience. The fact is there is a woman that's in my sights. For a strange reason, I don't know if it's going to work out, but sometime back I was at Smith College in Northampton, Massachusetts. I was looking at the, what's her name? I wrote about her for U of M, Mary Downing Sheldon. Anyway, one of the earliest women to go to the University of Michigan. Looking at her papers at Smith, and I was waiting for the archivist to get my stuff, and I saw that there was a collection of Clara Barton's papers at Smith College. I was looking at this, at the finding, what's called a finding aid, kind of the catalog of the papers, and I realized that Clara Barton got interested in spiritualism. So I thought, huh. And I'm thinking about writing more for children, and I thought, spiritualism, that's ghosts, and the Civil War, and this great figure of the Civil War. I thought, that might be something there to write about. So that's the way you get an early idea. You don't know where it's going to go, but that might go somewhere.
Over here, please.
One more question.
Bill Stott. You've got this blue blood, FDR, who suddenly has to communicate with the masses, who don't speak his language necessarily, who, you know, don't have his money, his stature. Did his disability, do you think, allow him to be more accepted by the general public? The fireside chats, the other examples.
Yeah, I think the answer is yes. I don't think that people could have seen FDR in the way they saw him if it had not been for polio. They knew he had gone through this great setback and come back from it. They knew he had had terrible hardship. So, I mean, his cousin Theodore was a blue blood and a much more effete character in some ways than Franklin Roosevelt was. He had been elected president. It was more common for people of that class to be in positions of power in that era, so this wasn't unusual. But, I mean, God, think about Woodrow Wilson. Talk about not having the common touch. FDR did have a common touch, with or without polio. FDR could talk with anyone. FDR was genuinely friends with tenant farmers around his estate in Hyde Park. Now, there was always, you know, an understanding of a difference in stature and status, but he made friends with all kinds of people. When he went to Warm Springs and then bought this resort, this old resort at Warm Springs and turned it into this polio rehabilitation center, he made friends with the townspeople who were poor, poor small town Southerners. He made friends with farmers in the area. So FDR liked people and was liked by people. That came through, but the polio, you know, which, as I say, it was there, it was present, it was part of his public personality for people to observe and regard and know about. He didn't talk about it much, but they grasped that that was him. You know, this is a guy who has suffered, and yet look at how ebullient he is, how much courage he has, how much faith he has in the future, which was communicated through his talks, both in person and, as you say, on the radio. I mean, those fireside chats, that was a revolution in presidential communication. FDR spoke beautifully, wrote beautifully. This is another way in which he kind of came into his own. There were no signs in his early life that he was much of a writer, but he doctored up his speeches, worked with his speechwriters, and it's his phrases we remember, a date that will live in infamy. You can see that penned into the scribbled notes on that typewritten speech. So FDR did have a way of speaking simply, plainly, eloquently. That appealed to people. But you know how it is with a politician. It's the whole package. And so polio is part of that, but not all of that. So, great question.
Please join me in thanking Jim Tobin.